Good morning, guys. Obviously, I know some of you, and I'm excited to be here today. So just as a little quick recap, also for folks who might be watching later, my name is Diana Ingalls. I am the owner of Empowered Fitness with my husband, Mike. And actually this month, next month, April, we're celebrating 10 years on the coast. So it's been just a great 10 years, and I'm excited to also just have some time here with the chamber to be able to talk about some ways we can make our life a little bit better. It's definitely been a crazy year. So a couple things. One is just a little bit background, and that is that I have been in the health and fitness industry for over 30 years, which every time I say that, it makes it feel it's like a really long time, both as a trainer, as an instructor, as a nutrition coach, and also as a business owner. And so I've had the opportunity to work with lots and lots of people over all kinds of different times in our community. And I'd say the last 12 months was probably the most challenging so far for all of us. And what comes to my attention and working with our folks is that when we have something as crazy and routine disrupting as a pandemic, which none of us have ever lived through something like this, it can really throw us off our game. And we have all had to reshift and deal with a lot of change and a lot of just kind of undercurrent of stress that's always going. And so for us to find ways to get some control back in a very kind of chaotic world is really, really important. And so one of the things that I find really works with our clients and just pretty much everybody is finding small and simple things that you can do consistently to start creating some changes, because what doesn't feel good is when we feel a little out of control. And we start finding that either it becomes harder and harder to get back to doing the things that are really important for us, or we just completely lose our way. So when I was talking with Crystalline about bringing an idea for a Learn at Lunch program, I really thought it'd be awesome to have just five simple things that if you started today, even just one of them, you would start to be able to see some change, and in a good way, kind of moving the dial forward. So that's what I'm going to be talking about today. And I'm going to go, if it's okay, to share the screen. Does that sound good? Okay, so let's see how awesome I am at this. Okay, let's see.
If I could just, while you're getting that ready,
yeah.
Thank you, Diana, and thank you everybody for joining us today. It's a real treat for the Chamber to bring these types of online learnings and help enrich everybody's lives.
Awesome. Well, I'm just excited. I feel like, in talking earlier when we were kind of before the program started, we were talking about how there's a lot of things that we know, right? We know things that are smart for us to do. And, but it's not always about just what we know. It's also about having the mojo and the motivation to actually do them. And then the magic secret sauce of working on certain habits is consistency. It's actually being able to do it often enough that we actually don't even have to make decisions about it. We just do these things. And so that's where I'd hope for today when you leave this this little session, is that there's at least one thing that you feel that you could start today that you're kind of pumped about that will help you move the dial forward. So I'm going to start with, by the way, I think this is like a little doll. I don't think this is a real little person, but it's talking about getting stuck in a rut. And that's a really big thing. I personally have gone through it. I know a lot of our clients have just had that feeling of like you're spinning your wheels. The days are kind of all blending into each other. And we start getting frustrated and stuck. And in fact, that's when we, I've stopped asking people, what are you doing this weekend? Because then they kind of look at me and they're like, hello, we're doing the same thing as all the other weekends. And so really thinking about what are some small things we can do to get, move forward. And I would tell you that just showing up here today or watching this little workshop is already moving forward. Just the idea that you're doing something starts building that excitement. And if you do the things that I'm going to be talking about today, I guarantee you, 100% guarantee you, you're going to feel better and you're going to start feeling like you're taking action. So we're going to start. And at any point, if you have questions, let me know. Okay, so of course, Kathy, Katie, those of you who know me, I'm going to talk about drinking more water. It's critical and it's so easy to forget. In fact, I've got mine right here. But the reason for the water, the reason I always come back to it is it's going to be one of the most non-invasive things that you can do immediately to start building up your hydration. Because honestly, most people are somewhat dehydrated unless they've been listening to me just rant over and over and they are finally like, I'm drinking all my water. General rule of thumb, half your body weight in ounces of water every day. And I really like to point that out because sometimes we just need some math. We just need just like, tell me what to do. And in fact, this whole workshop today is going to be, I'm just going to tell you what to do. You can do it. But the thing with water, which tricky is, your thirst, your mechanism for recognizing thirst is very, very weak. So if people are like, I just drink when I'm thirsty, I will tell you that you are probably already somewhat dehydrated. And so it's one of those things we need to keep ahead of it, because when, funny enough, when you start bringing up your water take, you actually a lot of times will start to lose weight. And people are like, wait, I don't, that doesn't make sense to me. But when you are not drinking enough water, your body actually is a little frightened that you are going to put it at risk. And so there'll be some bloat, you'll hold on to water. When you start flooding your body with water, then you start letting go of stored water that's been there for a while and just getting rid of it. So just so you know, when you first, if you take this on, you first start drinking a bunch of water, you may find that, yes, oh my gosh, this is also helping my get up and stand app, because I'm going to have to get up and use that restroom a ton, but it does level out. The other thing is muscle recovery, organ function, digestion. Your blood is comprised of 70% water. Your immune system requires you to be hydrated enough. And if there was ever a time to have a strong immune system, it is right now. And so that is, the drinking water is critical. So a couple of things, I know personally, I can be really good at carrying my water bottle all over the place, but the key is you have to drink it. So there's some quick tips that really help that. Okay, so you know you have to drink half your body weight in ounces. Strangely enough, so I keep bringing this up. I love that this has this, it's like a, you know, whatever, reusable straw. Do something to make it very easy to drink water at your desk. If you are somebody working and you're at your desk a good amount, you have to be drinking where you are spending time. So bringing water in your car. One of my clients says every time they fill up their water glass, they drink half of it and then they fill it up again and go back to their desk or whatever. But making sure that you're actually drinking the water is important. And a really good tip, drink a full glass the minute you wake up. We kind of talk about that a lot at the studio because that actually acts like a little bath for your body. Because when you sleep, we'll talk about sleep, but when you sleep is when all your muscle recovery happens, all the cleanup that your lymph system does for your body, all the kind of getting rid of waste and toxins, all happens when you sleep, and it creates kind of just leftover trash in your body. And that big glass of water when you wake up floods your system, gives you lots of energy. And for anyone who's like gotten into jumping up their water, has really probably noticed their skin feels better. You have more energy. You just feel better. So big tip, drink more water. And hopefully one of those tips will be really easy for you to incorporate. So I'm going to go on unless anybody has any questions on that. Yes, Crystalline.
Okay, so I'm going to take it to the potty, if that's okay. Yep. So for myself, and I don't know if this is true or not, I just heard like 1,000 years ago that you want your pee to be like as light yellow or clear as possible. So I play a game with myself, like, how clear can I get it? And I was just wondering, is that true? Is that like a good?
Yes, it is. Yes, and being that I've been in this industry for about 1,000 years, then yes. So it's a great indicator. And you can tell, like, if you've had like a long day and then you have like a couple glasses of wine or whatever, and the next, and you forgot to drink water, you will notice it. So keeping that very clear, very, very light is a great indicator that you're doing a great job. So, you know, if you want to play that game, go for it, but it gives you immediate feedback. It tells you that your body is doing its job, right? So that's a great one. Good. Glad you brought it up. All right, cool. All right. First, I'm going to talk about activity. But I don't know if you know this, but it's actually considered inactivity. It has become such a crisis in a country that has access all the time. We don't live in the Sahara Desert. We can do things. We can get outside. But inactivity is as bad for you as smoking. It is literally considered one of the top reasons, like without going too negative here, but one of the top indicators of death is if you are an inactive person. Now, I'm pretty certain I'm singing to the choir here. I know that you guys, whether you're clients of ours or if you are somebody who's in this workshop, it's because you already are thinking about how to take great care of yourself. It's very easy though to get out of your routine and moving your body. And I'm not going to tell you that it has to be really intense, really hard exercise all the time. Mixing things in that challenge your body is fantastic. But really what I'm talking about here is, again, what's one simple thing you can do? Move 30 minutes every day. And that may be 3 10-minute bouts. That may be, you know, I'll find if I am not necessarily doing a class, I'm getting out and walking my dog. Anytime you can get out in nature is a bonus. I do believe that that is also a great way to have stress relief. But honestly, the exercise, the stats around exercise makes you feel like you never want to not exercise. Raise your hand if you'd like to be active, moving, and vital, like for all the days of your life, right? Our bodies were meant to move, and we only get one. We only get one. So, I mean, as far as we know, but you know, as far as I know, we get one. So, it's meant to move. All our systems of our body, our immune system, our circulatory system, our skeletal system, our organ system, all of those are requiring us to move. And I always think it's so funny because, does anybody have a dog? Like, you have a dog. Can you imagine not taking your dog for a walk for like 2 months? I mean, there's no way, right? And, you know, our dog starts to go a little nuts though if it's like 2 days. And we're all little beings, we need to move. And so sometimes we get caught up in our day-to-day, we get kind of feeling down about things, we get tired. And actually those are all things that benefit, that become better as we move more. And I like to talk about people being exercise opportunists. So it doesn't always have to be out for a walk. I just find that easy because almost everybody has a pair of shoes. We live on the coast where it's almost always awesome. And you literally can have your shoes where you can find them and say, hey, I'm just going to go out for 10 minutes between a meeting or between something. But the other thing is you can be an exercise opportunist in your own house. You might have a few minutes. You can walk up and down your stairs. You could add some calf stretches and counter push-ups while you're waiting for your coffee because, you know, we're always in the kitchen doing something. So where I come back to for each of these slides is the fact that during this pandemic, during this very crazy time, it has been more important than ever, literally essential for us to take care of our immune system. And one of the key ways to do that besides water is to move your body and to build up that immunity, build up the, you know, take care of all the hormones in your body that help protect you from disease and from stress. So that's, you know, I'm all about finding time. Now, the big thing here is the more we can make this not something you have to decide about, the better. So in other words, if every day it's it's right now, it's almost noon, and you're like, I wonder if I should work out today. Pretty much that is not going to serve you, right? Because all these things are going to, oh my God, I got to write that, that email, and I got to do this, and I got to go to the store. And so it needs to be the thing you do. So whether you create a habit, and we'll talk about habits, but schedule it in. I have a lot of clients, including myself, will put on exercise clothes in the morning. And that way you're like ready to go. You can just bolt, because I don't know about you, but if it's 9:30 at night and I'm still wearing exercise clothes and they never got ever used, like I didn't use, that doesn't feel really good. So getting yourself out and moving every day. Any questions about that? And like I said, it doesn't have to be burpees and jacks and all kinds of crazy stuff. It's just moving, and then you can change the intensity as feels good for you. Okay, sleep. So I kind of talking about like crises, but inadequate sleep truly is a health crisis in our modern world. Generally, about a third of our population is under, like they don't have enough sleep. We're not getting enough adequate sleep. And I find it actually really interesting. I've been in this voice myself, no more, where a lot of folks almost feel like it's a badge of honor. I mean, have you ever heard like a friend going, oh my God, I only got 4 hours sleep. I was up really late working on this thing and did this other thing. It's not a badge of honor. It's very brutal on your body to not get enough sleep. And when I give you here like a tip, I'm saying get 7 hours of sleep. You may be like, oh, I need 8. Or, oh, you know what? I always get 5 and I'm fine. 7 hours is kind of the average minimum that, and I know some people, natural clock, so I'm not trying to be like hardline, but most of us need about 7 hours of sleep. The problem when we don't get enough sleep, and I can personally attest to this as a business owner, you start having what I call dark thoughts of like you don't feel very good. You don't necessarily respond well to situations. So things can make you more depressed than normal. Things can make you more angry than normal. Like our ability to absorb information in our world really goes down. And then what happens is we get that like brain fog. And again, brain fog is not cool. It's not fun. It is very detrimental to our day-to-day, just getting through our day. And it makes it very hard to do the really important things like drink our water, get our exercise, and it becomes very much a vicious cycle. And from my experience as a trainer and as a fitness business owner, I'll a lot of times have clients who are like, I'm doing all the things. I'm working out all the time. I feel like I'm eating really great and my weight is not changing. And I'll just stop for a second and say, tell me about your sleep patterns. And almost inevitably, I'm finding 5 hours sleep, 5.5 hours sleep, maybe on a good day, 6. So your lack of sleep absolutely can negatively impact your weight. And I don't know that people really put that together. We know it feels good to get enough sleep, but it actually truly impacts from a hormone level. Your hormone, it's called leptin, that tells you that you are full is decreased when you are sleep deprived. So you are literally not firing that hormone that's telling you you're full. So what does that happen late at night? It's like, I just can keep eating, nothing's happening. There's another hormone called ghrelin, which is the hormone that tells you you're hungry. That's firing on all cylinders. It's like the worst scenario when you are sleep deprived. Your body doesn't tell you you're full. In fact, it tells you you're hungry. So that right there, just people don't always realize that. The other thing is that your body does best, because I know a lot of us and a lot of like women in my age group, we can struggle as hormones shift with getting sleep or getting good sleep. And the trick is, you guys, is to figure out what time you need to get up in the morning. So for instance, like for me, it's fairly early. So if I want to get up at 5 a.m., I work backwards 7 hours. That needs to be your bedtime, as opposed to, I'm going to stay up till midnight. Now I got to wake up at 7. That's too late. I'm going to work backwards from when you want to wake up and try to make that consistent most days. Do I want to get up at 5 a.m. on Saturday? Not a lot, but I'll get up at 6 because I want to keep it fairly close. Because then your body actually has the ability to start creating that your personal kind of sleep schedule, and you'll become more sleepy at the appropriate time at night. So if that makes sense, right? So you pick your early morning time that you want to get up, that's typically good for you, work backwards 7 hours, and start creating that nighttime, that bedtime for you. And then, of course, we talk a lot about, and you've heard a lot about, how do you then make that bedtime kind of ritualistic? So again, your body starts building its, preparing the descent. You know, when you're on an airplane and you're like cruising along and they're like, okay, we're coming into San Francisco in the next 20 minutes and they start going down. That's kind of that feeling, like preparing your descent. You turn off electronics. Ideally, you don't have them in your room, or at least I do have my phone in my room, but I try not to look at it late. Maybe you are having some tea or something that's calming. Maybe you are starting to like slow down. You have your little nighttime rituals. Preparing your descent tells your body, I'm getting ready for bed. Most of us don't just go from a full sprint, full sprawl, jump into bed and we're out. We need to kind of prep that. So really important, number one tip, get 7 hours sleep. But how are you going to do that and working backwards? And if you need more or possibly a little less, it gives you some tips to do that. Does anybody have questions about that one? Okay, it's a game changer. I have just a quick little story. So when we first opened Empowered Fitness a while back, and I was teaching a ton of classes, we had earlys, lates, whatever, I was teaching a lot. And I thought I was being really healthy, like how I ate, trying to, you know, keep myself busy. And weight was starting to creep on. I'm like, this is not the best marketing. Like, you know, here I am doing this fitness business and weight's creeping on. And it can't, and I was starting to get, you know, like everything felt overwhelming and I was just getting stressed. 100%, I was not getting enough sleep. I was probably getting between 4 and 6 hours of sleep every night. And it took me a second to step back and really go like, what's really happening? And I can always tell now, like if I start to feel like we all, as a little sidebar, we all are dealing with a kind of buzz of stress from the pandemic. It's always there for us right now. And so this little buzz that's always happening is kind of taking some of our energy. And more than ever, we need to get enough sleep so that we can handle all the ups and downs that are happening. So I'm sure you can kind of look back at times you weren't getting as much sleep and felt that, you know, you could really see that change. So that's a great one right there. If you did nothing else, focus there. Okay, fourth one, keeping us going here. Yes.
We have a couple of sleep questions.
Ooh, would love that. Okay, I'll go back.
Yes.
There we go. Yes.
We had a question about, is there a thing of too much sleep? What happens when you get 9 or 10 hours?
Oh, that's a great question. So here's kind of what can happen. It can depend. Like, for instance, and I'm just going to back up a little, we don't necessarily make up sleep. So if you sleep 2 hours one day, yes, you're going to be kind of tired the next day. But what if too much sleep, usually you can tell, you feel kind of groggy. It's kind of like if you have a nap in the middle of the day and it ends up being like 4 hours, which I don't even remember what that would be like. But if you did, you can feel groggy. So I don't know, you know, again, if you, different people have different body clocks. 9-10 hours sleep, it may be what someone needs, but most likely what's happening is some days they're getting less and some days they're getting more. And what they have found has really helped people kind of steady things out is to practice pretty loosely, I'm sure on weekends, but to practice getting the same wake up. And then that will kind of, and then working backwards, that will kind of level things out a little bit. You know, I'm not a physician of sleep issues, but from what I've studied and what we, you know, what we can kind of pull together, it really depends. I just know that if you typically get up at 5 and then on a Saturday, you get up at 10:30 in the morning, you may end up feeling actually kind of groggy and slow, like your whole clock became off. And then you're going to try to retrain it for Sunday night to be ready for Monday. And that can be more difficult. And as I feel like as we get older, we don't need as much sleep like a growing teen. We have a, you know, 16-year-old. She needs like 9, 8, 9, 10 hours of sleep because she's growing. We're not necessarily growing. Goodness knows we don't want to grow. We just want to just stay where we are and keep, you know, being awesome, but we're not growing. So we don't need the same amount of sleep typically. I hope that helps.
And then one more question was, so what if somebody has, doesn't really have a problem falling asleep, but they have a problem staying asleep? Is there any tips for that?
That's actually, so a lot of times I look back and again, there are also issues with hormones. So, and that there's, you know, there's a number of things that may be going on that I, you know, wouldn't necessarily be in my lane to talk about, but there's a couple things. One is to look backwards at what you ate before bed. So in other words, you know, not to be like, you know, the fun killer over here, but, you know, alcohol before bed, so alcohol in the evening, your body actually spends a good amount of time processing that. And a lot of times, like 3, 4 in the morning, depending on when you went to bed, is when a lot of that's processed, and that can wake you up, or you're potentially dehydrated at that time. So alcohol is a big one to look back on. When we do like our cleanses or our Get Lean Challenge, and people are like, all right, I'm taking a month off or whatever, they're like, oh my gosh, my sleep is so much better. So what you can do is kind of be a little bit of a detective. If you're somebody that's having a real struggle staying asleep all night, you know, look back, look at your habits before you went to bed. Sometimes we're so wired, you know, our subconscious is going all night. Our bodies are working actually really hard all night, kind of doing the cleanup. It's cleanup crew in the middle of the night, and the repair crew. So looking backwards, I know that may not, you know, you may have done all those things or doing everything right and you're still struggling. And a lot of times then that needs to be something, maybe checking in with your doctor, or if, you know, menopause is not the coolest for sleep, just saying personally, but you, again, trying to do as much as you can, setting yourself up. And if you get your exercise, by the way, that also really helps you have a good night's sleep. I hope. Any other questions? Okay, I'm going to move on. Number 4, eat a lean protein at every meal. And for any of you guys who have done our nutrition coaching programs, you know, we talk about this because our bodies need 3 macronutrients every single day throughout the day. We need proteins, we need carbs, and we need healthy fats. And so what happens is, we need to have those at every meal for our body to do all the different processes it needs to do and to also sustain us till the next time we eat. And so, I mean, who's ever done this? I'm just going to grab an apple and head out the door, right? I mean, most people at some point have done that. And what happens is your body like blows through that apple. It's a carbohydrate. It processes it fairly quickly. It's great. It has, you know, fiber in it. But it doesn't have the sustaining quality that a protein does. So just from a hunger standpoint, this is purely from a hunger standpoint, you need having that protein, that healthy fat, and that carb in your meal is going to help sustain you, balance your blood sugar. So that's going to mean you're going to have less of the dip in your energy, in your brain function. So that's just from like how you feel. But from a very much more important or equally very important concept is your body requires that protein for muscle regeneration, for serving your organs. It actually is going to use it to produce hormones. And it's doing that all the time. So you know, even if you're resting, your body's like working, and your body doesn't store protein. So in order to get it, it's either going to go with what you ate. So that's another reason why you don't want to go huge long periods of time without eating. But otherwise, if you start skipping protein, so this can happen when someone's like, I'm doing this really cool diet. All I eat is cabbage. Well, guess what's going to happen? Your body's going to go after your muscle because there's protein right there. And it's going to do that. And I don't know if you've ever known somebody to do it like a crazy fad diet or something. They lose a bunch of weight. They can sometimes look kind of like gaunt, but they might lose that weight. And then 2 months later, they gained it all back in spades. That's because that body went after that muscle in order to get what it needed to do the jobs to keep you going. So I'm a huge believer in eating a lean protein at any meal, at every meal, and being able to recognize it. So lean proteins can be plant-based, absolutely. They can be animal-based. But you do want to also look at lean because, you know, if you convince yourself that bacon is protein and that's your protein source, then we're going to have some problems around, you know, heart disease and trans fats and just not being as healthy. So that's a big one. And for folks that I work with also, nobody likes to be hungry. Like pretty much every client that I work with is excited to be lean. Lean is great and lean feels good. Starving and hungry and wanting to kill your family because you're hungry is not fun. And so making sure also that you have protein to sustain your blood sugar and to keep you full is also really important. So that's just an easy, make sure you recognize your protein and you get some in every meal. Any questions? Yeah, Kristalyn.
Yes, we had a question from the chat. Is it important to have protein with every single meal, or is there such thing as a protein quota in case you have a lot of protein with one meal and then skip it for another?
Oh, that's such a great question. Great. Okay. So great question. So when we talk about quotas, right? So again, your body doesn't store protein. So what's more important is to have kind of a small, like 2 to 4 ounces, like 2 ounces of chicken, 4 ounces of chicken, a portion of like Greek yogurt, like 2/3 cup. We're not talking like a whole steak. We're talking small amounts because your body doesn't store it as protein. Your body stores anything extra that you eat as fat, period. And so, it also depends. That question is great because it also depends how often. If you're like, yay, I love eating 7 meals a day, I'm cranking out my protein, you are going to have a weight problem. You're going to be bummed. So typically what we coach, like with our programs, our nutrition programs, is kind of a 4 meals a day. It might be 3 meals a day with kind of a, you know, a kind of a solid snack that's got your 3 macros. We're not talking about eating like snacks all day, make sure there's always protein because you will overeat. But typically 3 to 4 meals a day is the way to go. And I'll tell you this little story for anybody local. So love getting like wild salmon. We used to go to Mezzaluna and I get the salmon. I'd be like so excited. I'm like, all right, this is rocking. I'm going to eat the whole thing. My hair is going to be amazing. My skin's going to be amazing. You know, I'm just so healthy. Okay, well, so my body, if I had a piece of, you know, salmon this big, my body only needed that much. It only needed the 2 to 4 ounces. Everything else I should have taken home and had at a future meal, put with my salad or whatever, because I was so excited about that protein. My body used what it needed. It stored the rest as fat. Bummer. So your body is like, yay, you know, back to Neanderthal times. Anything extra was stored as fat because your body then used that for future energy. We don't need to save energy like that so much. We want to actually lose body fat. And so eating lean protein periodically in your day actually really does help you not overeat. And another really good tip, you guys, is eat the protein first. So if you have a meal and eat the protein first, go to your vegetables. You can never overeat veggies, so go with that. But have the starchy carbs last or smaller amount. I have yet to meet someone who has a hard time eating carbs. It just doesn't really happen. But if you eat your protein first, you're already signaling your body. Those getting full hormones start to signal. And that also helps you from overeating. Because I don't know if anyone's like been really hungry and like you had the fries, like, man, those go fast and you don't even notice. And if you start with the protein, you're more likely to eat a little bit less. So those are great questions. Does anybody else have any? I'll go to our next one to keep you guys. All right, breathe. The key word on here is mindful breathing. Does anybody have like the thing on their watch that says, you know, I'll be doing some and I'll get the little tickle and it'll be all time to breathe. And I just want to like tell it to shut up because I'm like, I am. This is actually talking about rebooting your nervous system. And this is something that's been brought to my attention. It's been hugely, hugely helpful. And that's why I wanted to share it. Like I talked about earlier, we're all dealing at this time in our world with a level of stress that's always there because of pandemic and COVID and just all the new routines and things that have happened. And it can kind of rev us high. And that isn't always going to be in our favor. We may, you know, feel like, oh, I'm getting lots of stuff done, but it can make you actually feel anxious. It can create stress eating. It can create loss of sleep. You forget to drink your water. I mean, honestly, all these things start to fall apart if we are revving so high and we are having that kind of anxious feeling. And so there's a kind of practice breathing. I thought we could all do it for like 1 minute, called 4-7-8 breathing. And so it's a practice. I actually do it in the car. It doesn't like knock you out or put you in a meditative state. So you can do it in the car. But it's also really cool to do at night when you are looking to calm down. From my experience, just for me, if I'm starting to feel a little frazzly or I get a text that gives me some kind of emotional connection that's like not the best, having this reboot method is a great way to remind yourself that you can reset your nervous system at any time and bring things down. So I'm going to take you through it. What 4-7-8 talks about is you get yourself comfortable and you're going to do a deep inhale. You put your tongue behind your teeth and you do a deep inhale through your nose for the count of four. So you'll do that for four. You then hold that breath in your lungs for a count of seven. And then you exhale loudly, and don't worry because all you guys are muted, just exhale loudly for a count of eight. Let's do it like two times. So I'm going to show you, here's the reminder. Okay, so we're just going to get comfortable, shoulders back, sit tall, and just breathe in through your nose for a count of four to yourself. Now hold it for seven. And breathe out for eight. And then bring it back in for four. Hold it, lungs are full. And breathe it out. And it's actually, you can take a break, you can keep going. But that practice, and I try to do it, I try to give myself like a little game, like, okay, I'm going to do it five times. And breathing out through your mouth, like blowing out or like you're blowing through a straw or having your tongue kind of behind your teeth, forces that air out in a way. And it's just a reset. It's literally, I find this so fascinating because it literally changes inside your body. It changes how your whole nervous system is reacting. And I've, you know, what's been shared with me on that is, isn't it exciting that we have access to that at any time, like literally any time you could take a second, it takes just a few moments and do that. So I thought that was a great one to have as a final tip. So that is the five tips, okay? But I have a couple more slides I want you guys to see. But the five tips are definitely drink your water, figure out the math, half your body weight in ounces. If you're not sure you can do that, fill up, go find all the random water bottles in your house and fill up with that many ounces, have it on the counter and just drink from that during the day and see if you get there. If it's like 9 at night and you still have 2 bottles left, then you're probably going to have to get up in the middle of the night, but you can then start figuring out how to slip that in. Okay, you've got to have your exercise every day. Get out and move. If you can't leave the house, it's yucky out, get some stretches in, be an exercise opportunist. Number 3 is going to be getting in the sleep. So work backwards from when you'd like to get up most days and then figure out your new bedtime or current bedtime. Eat your protein at every meal, make sure you can recognize it, and then try practicing, you know, try it just at bedtime. Tonight, try the 4-7-8 breathing. So a couple extra slides. I feel like the best thing in the whole wide world is to not wonder how are you gonna add this into your life in a way that creates a lot more time and a lot more headspace. How could we make this so easy to add one thing to your world? And that's called habit stacking. Taking something you already do. So I always talk about this one because I literally make a cup of coffee every single day. In fact, at night before, I'm like already excited about next day's coffee. And so during that time, I do calf stretches because my calves are usually too tight. Or during that time, I could figure out what I'm going to food prep that day. Or what is my protein going to be at breakfast? Like, I'm like, no, I really actually have to eat a breakfast. Coffee is not breakfast. So using that, you know, if you always take a lunch break, what if you went out and walked for 10 minutes? Sometimes you have to remind yourself when you're like, I don't have time. And you're like, I literally would be back in the house in 10 minutes or 15 minutes. I could get a little bit of a walk. So habit stacking is take something you do every day, right? Whether it's you're already going to be getting your bag ready for work or whatever. Get your workout shoes out where you can see them. So habit stacking is take something you do every day already and add one thing, or you may want to add all 5. That is up to you. But I would love for you to make a list of things you do all the time and find one thing you could add. Okay. And then here's really important, you guys. This is so important to your health and well-being, and it's the best thing ever. Laughing. Okay. So laughing. I wish you could see my notes on like how many things it helps with. It is literally, there is science behind. If you get a good laugh, and this is like, let your laugh go, by the way. No, like, don't, you know, I mean, obviously maybe wear a mask if you're with your friends, but like big laugh, 45 minutes, you have the bonus effects of like your body feeling really good and having that endorphin hit for 45 minutes. Your body is more relaxed after a big laugh, right? And it protects your heart. It actually opens up the blood vessels in your heart. It gets your heart pumping. Endorphins come out when you laugh. It's like you get chills, like it's so exciting. So how do you laugh more? Because sometimes you're like, there's nothing to laugh at. Literally, okay, I'm gonna call out my husband, Mike. He watches like cat videos on his phone sometimes, like we're sitting there and he'll just start laughing. And of course, then I'm like, well, what are you laughing at? And then like, so funny videos, put yourself near people who are funny. I literally at class, at our outside classes, will make myself near somebody who always makes me laugh because then I know I'm gonna laugh more. So find a way to add some laughter into your life. I swear it makes everything better. And when you think you're having a hard time, if you can find something to laugh about, you literally feel so much better. So that's like a bonus. That's just like a fun thing, but why not? Okay. And then I'm going to just say to you guys, I'm just about done here, but here's the biggest thing. We are only going to get to where we want to go if we start changing things up, unless we're already there. Like if anyone's already arrived at like the awesome train, like let me know, because you know, we're all in a state of trying to be better, trying to be a little bit more. And the only way to get there is to be okay with trying something different or pushing ourselves or setting ourselves up for success. And it's not always comfortable. And so what I'm saying to you is start imagining yourself already doing it. like I'm already imagining myself, you know, getting in that extra walk every day or walking a little longer because I'm already out. I can add a little time or whatever it is. Imagine yourself already doing it because that way you're much more likely to get there than if you come back to me and you're like, Diana, those are great and all, but I don't have time for any of those. Then you're probably not going to do them and you're probably going to stay exactly where you are. So that is just something from a subconscious level. The more you really picture yourself achieving it and succeeding and looking and feeling amazing, the more likely you're going to get there. So that's just a big one to kind of come back to, is remember to always imagine yourself already being successful real time. And that's actually my wrap, my slides. I did make this little checklist and I left a blank for you to fill in your own. I'm going to email this to anybody, or actually everybody who attended today. I'll make it accessible. And it's just a little checklist with the ideas that I threw out. So like the one thing to do today, plus maybe a couple of other ideas that I had. And then I left a blank one. So if you have your own, or maybe you want to put the habits that you already do, you want to write down where you're going to do this in your day, whatever. If you find that helpful, I just thought it'd be kind of nice to have it all kind of summed up for you. And as easy as you can make it is going to be the key. As easy as you can make it, simple, simple, simple. Actually, let me take that back. Simple is not always easy, but simple is simple. So I want to keep it that way. And then if any of you guys would like extra support, you know, of course you can find me. We have our Get Lean Challenge that's going to be happening in a few weeks, actually 2 weeks, but that's also around reminding people and supporting people around habits. So that's something there as well. But I'll go back to our checklist if you want to just check that out and open it up to questions. All right. Thank you so much. Have a great day, you guys.
Thanks, Diana.
Bye.